You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with the first virtual bilateral summit held between India and Australia. The two sides signed 7 agreements to provide an impetus to the relationship that has grown stronger in the recent times. They also unveiled a shared vision for maritime cooperation in the Indo-Pacific. Incidentally, the two countries are also part of the group which has expressed its willingness in initiating an investigation into origins of coronavirus outbreak.
In the first ever virtual bilateral summit of Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi with his Australian counterpart Scott Morrison, New Delhi and Canberra decided to elevate their relationship to comprehensive strategic partnership. The two sides upgraded their 2+2 foreign affairs and defence dialogue to the ministerial level during the first virtual summit of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. They also unveiled a shared vision for maritime cooperation in the Indo-Pacific and signed 7 agreements focused on crucial areas. The countries also said that they would work together to help the world recover from the social and economic impact of the coronavirus that has killed over 385,000 people globally.
वैश्विक महामारी के इस काल में हमारी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव स्ट्रेटेजिक पार्टनरशिप की भूमिका और महत्वपूर्ण रहेगी। विश्व को इस महामारी के आर्थिक और सामाजिक दुष्प्रभावों से जल्दी निकालने के लिए एक कोऑर्डिनेटर और कोलैबोरेटिव अप्रोच की आवश्यकता है। हमारी सरकार ने इस क्राइसिस को एक अपॉर्चुनिटी की तरह देखने का निर्णय लिया है। भारत में लगभग सभी क्षेत्रों में व्यापक रिफॉर्म्स की प्रक्रिया शुरू की जा चुकी है। बहुत जल्द ही ग्राउंड लेवल पर इसके परिणाम देखने को मिलेंगे।
The two countries also sealed a deal to get access to each other's military bases. The Indian Foreign Ministry said a pact that would clear the way for more military exchanges and exercises in the Indo-Pacific. The two leaders also signed the Mutual Logistics Support Agreement.
The Mutual Logistics Support Arrangement and a Defence Science and Technology Implementing Arrangement. These are the substantial things that good friends develop together that provide the opportunity for the many other commercial opportunities that come our way. In a time like this, we want to deal very much with friends and trusted partners. And this is a partnership which has stood the test time and again and is during the course of this current crisis. We share a vision for open, free, rules-based multilateral systems in our region.
India has similar pact with the United States, which is seen as part of broader security cooperation to balance China's growing economic and military weight in the region.
भारत ऑस्ट्रेलिया के साथ अपने संबंधों को व्यापक तौर पर और तेज गति से बढ़ाने के लिए प्रतिबद्ध है। यह न सिर्फ हमारे दोनों देशों के लिए महत्वपूर्ण है बल्कि इंडो पैसिफिक क्षेत्र और विश्व के लिए भी आवश्यक है।
Morrison was due to visit India in January this year but forced to cancel the trip because of the bushfires crisis in Australia. The holding of the summit now, in the middle of the pandemic, showed the importance the two leaders attached to bilateral ties.
Moving on. While the COVID-19 has destabilized almost every system in the world, its impact on the people of illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan has been disastrous. Reason? The callous administration's apathy. Even after months of outbreak, the region is struggling to procure the basic medical infrastructure required to fight the pandemic. With the actual figures unknown, the cases are rising fast and the future of patients is uncertain. The ripple effects are even bigger, with economic activity almost shut and the unemployment rate near an all-time high. The so-called government in the region hasn't bothered to provide any form of relief. A report.
The quality of life of people living in the illegally occupied territory of Gilgit-Baltistan has deteriorated from bad to worse due to the pandemic COVID-19. The spread of the virus has affected more than one aspect of their life. While on one side, the unavailability of medical equipments even after months of the outbreak appears a systematic diabolical design. A sharp rise in the unemployment tables has imposed threats of widespread poverty. Locals who have managed to live by themselves till now accuses administrators of filling their own coffers with the money they are receiving as aid. People have also criticized the knee-jerk reaction of authorities to curb the spread, which they say hasn't addressed the real issue and has instead created unnecessary troubles.
कोरोना की वजह से हमारे गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान में बेइंतहा बेरोजगारी हो गई है ना कोई रोजगार है ना कोई ऐसा सिस्टम है बहुत परेशान हाल है बहुत महंगाई आसमान से बातें कर रही है बेरोजगारी आसमान से बातें कर रही है और गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से कोई खास वैसा कोई वो नहीं है जो होना चाहिए कि जैसा उन्होंने लॉकडाउन का जो सिस्टम शुरू कर दिया है जो टाइमिंग उन्होंने रखा हुआ है इस टाइम से 5 बजे तक का 5 बजे के बाद के कोरोना नहीं होता है ये सब ये गवर्नमेंट की पॉलिसियाँ हैं गवर्नमेंट का सिस्टम है उनको बाहर से फंड वगैरह आता है बाहर से उनको डोनेशन वगैरह आते हैं तो इस वजह से ये है कि ये अपना ही देखते हैं बाकी आवाम को नहीं देखते हैं हालांकि आवाम से ही ये लोग आ गए हैं ये खुद तो नहीं है आवाम ने उनको मैंडेट दिया हुआ है आवाम ने ही उनको वोट देकर आवाम ने ही उनको ये अपने इतने ऊँचे पोस्ट में उनको ज़रा पहुँचाया हुआ है तो लिहाजा ये है कि मैं दरख्वास्त करता हूँ मैं रिक्वेस्ट करता हूँ वक्त के हुक्मरानों से कि खुदा रहा जो है हमारे गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान की तरफ भी कोई नज़रसानी करें पसमंदा इलाका है वैसे ही बेरोजगारी इतनी थी उसमें मजीद और बेरोजगारी बढ़ गई है
People are unable to earn amidst an environment of restriction. While the operations around the world have resumed with careful measures, the region continues to suffer under a lockdown. The administrators have no option but to keep the people confined as they are ill-prepared to take on the virus even now. A more satanic design, however, has emerged during the crisis. Locals claim that these people who were supposed to be leading the fight against the virus have exploited it for their own benefits. They are reporting more numbers to claim more compensation from international bodies.
तकरीबन 600-700 के करीब बढ़ गए हैं लेकिन ये बढ़ क्या गए हैं ये कि वो रिपोर्ट आती है पॉजिटिव आदमी को थोड़ा सा भी गर्मी हो गया थोड़ा सा वो हो गया तो ये है कि उसको वो शो करता है पॉजिटिव हालांकि ऐसा कुछ ऐसा कोई सिस्टम नहीं है ऐसा कोई सिम्टम्स नहीं आते हैं जिसकी वजह से ये कि उनको कोरोना हो गया होगा लेकिन गवर्नमेंट को उसका फ़ायदा है इस वजह से उनका आगे से वो माल मिलता है पैसे मिलते हैं तो इस वजह से ये है कि वो ये उन्होंने पॉजिटिव शो करके अपना रेशो ज़रा बढ़ा रहे हैं ऐसा कुछ नहीं है ये WHO है ये उनके साथ इलाक है इनके साथ वो टच में हैं ये उनको पैसे देती है गवर्नमेंट को वो उनको रेशो बढ़ाते हैं वो इनका अपना परफॉर्मेंस दे दिखाते हैं कि इतने लोगों इतने पेशेंट हो गए इतने उसको सेहतियाब हो गए
Gilgit-Baltistan is under Pakistan's forceful occupation where the government hardly cares about their concerns. The region has already reported over 700 cases, but no sense of urgency has been shown by those who claim the region as their own. A record low number of testing in the region with a population of 15 lakh not only reflect Pakistani intent for the region, but also raises an alarm for the number of casualties the region could report in coming times.
Moving on to India, where even after the mounting case count and death toll, the country is much better positioned in comparison to others, with its preventive measures playing an active part. Its efforts to bring back its stranded citizens under its repatriation programs are also in continuity. Along with the government, the citizens too are rigorous in its attempts to spread awareness about the deadly virus. We have a report.
With an average of 1.2 lakh samples being tested for COVID-19 per day, India is definitely taking huge strides in its battle against COVID-19. While the country's testing capacity has increased, the number of labs testing for the virus has also soared. Presently, there are 476 government and 205 private labs conducting tests for COVID-19. Moreover, the country's preventive measures to curtail the virus are proving to be very effective, and as a result, if we compare India with other countries, the former is much better positioned. About 14 most affected countries, with a cumulative population almost equal to that of India, have reported 55.2 times more COVID-19 deaths and 22.5 times more cases. Even the country's fatality rate is amongst the lowest in the world, and it's all due to the timely identification of the cases and proper clinical management.
Continuous efforts jo field par rahe hain, either in terms of surveillance or in terms of contact tracing, ya hum kaise early case identification par focus karein aur saath mein jo case positive aaye usko hum clinically kaise tarike se manage karein, un efforts ke tahat hum pa rahe hain ki jaise ki 15 april mein agar desh ka case fatality rate kareeb 3.3% tha, vah ghata 3.25% hua, ghatte ghatte 3.15% और अब वह घटकर 2.82% हो चुका है. इसी कंपैरिजन को अगर हम फैटेलिटी रेट को अगर हम देखें तो हम पाते हैं कि हमारे देश का फैटेलिटी रेट इज़ अमंग द लोएस्ट इन द वर्ल्ड. इसके बारे में जैसे कि मैं ग्राफ में आप लोगों की दृष्टि में लाना चाहूँगा कि अगर दुनिया की पॉपुलेशन के हिसाब से हम देखें तो फैटेलिटी रेट जो पॉजिटिव केसेज आए हैं पूरी दुनिया में, अगर पूरी दुनिया में फैटेलिटी रेट 6.13% है तो वह हमारे देश में एज लो एज 2.82% है.
India's massive repatriation drive to bring back its stranded citizens from the other countries is also in progress. Recently, under the Operation Samudra Setu, Indian naval ship Jalashwa brought back around 700 of its stranded citizens who were stuck in Sri Lanka amid global coronavirus pandemic. The citizens were brought back with complete precautions, and the whole ship was divided into three zones: red, orange, and green. Evacuated citizens were kept in the red zone. Those who interact and take care of the evacuees were put in orange zones, and crew and sailors were in green zones.
These 700 Indians have been here for a few months because of the COVID-19 related situation, the inability to travel back. And today, Indian Navy is proudly adding one more chapter to its volumes of its glorious deeds in the service of the nation.
We thank the Navy people and the Indian Commission for having brought us back home safe. We had a very pleasant trip.
Along with the government and administration, artists across the country too are busy battling the virus with their creativity. In Guwahati city of Assam, they painted coronavirus themed artworks on walls to generate awareness about the deadly virus and appreciate frontline workers. A graffiti resembling a microscope image of coronavirus urged people to stay at home in a bid to stop the virus from spreading.
और हम लोग ये पेंटिंग के थ्रू मतलब लोगों को जागरूक कर रहे हैं कि कैसे सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग मेंटेन करना है, क्या करना है, और हम लोग थैंक्स भी दे रहे हैं सभी वॉरियर्स को जो भी हमने इस कोरोना में पार्टिसिपेट किए हैं, उन लोग को हम लोग हेल्प जो कर रहे हैं उनको धन्यवाद दे रहे हैं.
World's biggest lockdown, along with the extensive government campaign of social distancing and hygiene, have so far given positive results and is doing much better than several other affected countries.
Moving on to war torn Afghanistan, where the real stakeholders have seemingly reached the negotiation table to develop a mutually agreed long-lasting solution for the decades-old war. The stalled intra-Afghan talk, which was set to begin after the peace deal in Doha, is breathing a new life with increased momentum in the peace process. After assuming office in the Ghani government, Abdullah Abdullah is playing protagonist in the Afghan-Taliban talks by heading the chair of the Reconciliation Council. He recently announced that the Kabul government is set to begin the talks and urged the Taliban to maintain ceasefire during the negotiations. A report.
A US-Taliban peace deal, an expected intra-Afghan peace talks, prisoner release and an unprecedented ceasefire sum up the current situation of Afghanistan. Positive signs have been coming in from last few days from the country, raising hopes of an end to the 19-year-old war in Afghanistan. First, the release of Taliban prisoners by Afghan government and then an unexpected ceasefire by the Taliban insurgent group have brought the negotiating teams closer at the talking table. Though there have been small incidents of terror attacks and splits, but the leaders are hopeful of reaching a concrete and adaptable solution in the near future. Urging the Taliban to maintain ceasefire during the negotiation process between the Taliban and the Afghan government, Abdullah Abdullah, Afghanistan's chairman of the High Council for National Reconciliation, recently intimated that Kabul is all set to conduct talks with the Taliban.
تأكيد میکنم که برای شروع مذاکره همه مصمم هستیم. تیم هر لحظه آمادگی شروع مذاکره را دارن. ای که فضای مذاکره باید یک فضای باشه که کمک کننده باشه و تسهیل کننده باشه، کاهش خشونت و ادامه کاهش خشونت ضروری میسازه. بالاخره باید آتش بس داشته باشیم در جریان مذاکرات، چرا مسئله است که باز انتظار مردم افغانستان همیست.
Abdullah also hailed a three-day ceasefire by the Taliban for the Eid al-Fitr, which was reciprocated by the Afghan government. The decision came as fighting between the two sides had intensified despite the coronavirus pandemic. US welcomed the three-day ceasefire from both the sides.
اخیراً علائم خوب را شاهدش هستیم. ایران آتش بس و نبودن خشونت به او حدی که قبل از آتش بس وجود داشت و تبادل زندانیان که بر رقم بسیار قابل ملاحظه صورت گرفته، اینا شرایط مساعدی را ایجاد کرده. ما وقت اعلان کرده نمیتونم، اما هر لحظه تیم جمهوری اسلامی افغانستان آماده شروع مذاکره هست.
In appreciation to Taliban ceasefire, Afghan government released 900 prisoners, honoring the US Taliban peace deal signed in Doha. The prisoner exchange is a precursor to the peace talks, and the government said an extension in the ceasefire was important to furthering the peace process. The Taliban welcomed the prisoner release and said they would reciprocate soon, but said nothing about extending the ceasefire. Abdullah signed an agreement to share power with his rival President Ashraf Ghani on May 17, ending a months-long impasse over a disputed election and raising hopes that the government would now focus on the US-brokered peace process effort.
Moving on. When the world is grappling with the virus and depression, a first-of-its-kind drive-in concert brought relief and smiles for the revelers in the Sri Lankan capital, Colombo. As part of the government's Restart Sri Lanka initiative, the first experimental concert post-COVID-19 was held in capital's domestic Ratmalana Airport. The country was under a strict lockdown for weeks and succeeded in containing the virus that has otherwise exposed health systems across the world and has ravaged countries' economies.
Hundreds of revelers drove into Ratmalana, the domestic airport in Sri Lankan capital Colombo, and rejoiced the first experimental concert organized in country post the outbreak of COVID-19. The tarmac of the airport was packed with hundreds of vehicles on 30th May and 1st June after the scheduled event of 31st May was called off due to a mandatory lockdown. The two-hour performance, organized by two of island's most popular young musicians, Bhatia and Santosh, was also broadcasted live on radio and TV.
It's done under strict controls. So people were asking a lot of questions. Is this safe? Is this not safe? What's happening? I must say that the authorities came up with a proper plan. As you can see, the park, from the time that you come in, your safety is at utmost, you know, it is utmost important.
The concert was announced on May 26 when strict lockdown restrictions were lifted throughout the island nation. Tickets were sold out online in a few hours. The second concert, originally planned for May 31st, had to be postponed to June 1st after the government declared a 24-hour curfew for that day.
අතර මේක හොඳ මේ වැඩක් මොකද රටක් විදිහට ආයේ රැගෙන්න ඕනේ ඉතින් නගිනකොට මේ වගේ දෙයකින් පටන් ගැනීම මම හිතන ඉතාම හොඳ කාර්යයක් මේක
The money from the sales of the ticket will be donated to President's Coronavirus Fund. Sri Lanka has 1,620 infections and 10 deaths due to the virus as of Sunday.
This is an exercise done by the Sri Lankan entertainment industry to see how we can restart the industry in a safe manner.
Sri Lanka plans to reopen its tourism sector on August 1st by allowing only small groups of visitors to begin with, a tourism official said on Sunday. A limited number of small groups from around the world would be allowed to visit from August and stay in approved five-star hotels that have put strict safety measures in place. The country attracted around 2 million tourists last year, and the sector contributes around 11% to the nation's gross domestic product. Tourists will be required to carry a COVID-19-free certificate issued either by their governments or a reputed agency. Tourists would also need to wait on arrival at the airport for coronavirus testing.
Governments across the globe are putting in several efforts to restore both physical and mental health of their citizens. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.